Welcome back to Physical Chemistry 2. In this lecture, we will look at collisions of gas molecules and at the general transport properties of gases. So this week, we will discuss the mean free path. So the mean free path is a distance traveled between collisions. And we will then investigate how many collisions occur in a time unit and a unit of volume between similar gas molecules and in between different gas molecules. We will also calculate how many collisions a molecule undergoes in total. Yeah, and knowledge of these numbers of collisions will then be useful when we discuss the kinetics of reactions in the gas space. Yeah? And finally, we will derive a transport equation that is generally applicable to all kinds of transport phenomena, yeah, the transport of mass and the transport of energy. And this is then applicable in effusion, diffusion, internal friction, and the thermal conductivity in gases. First, let's look at the mean free path of gas molecules in a zero-D particle beam. So it means the incoming molecules are point particles, and we generate our particle beam as described in previous lectures. Yeah, so you saw that apparatus where we essentially have an oven, yeah, and we pass with an opening, and we pass that cone of particles. There are several apertures, yeah, to generate a beam. Yeah, so if a gas is then present, yeah, an ideal gas is present under normal conditions, that means room temperature and one atmosphere, then we know we've got Avogadro's number of gas molecules, yeah, which is 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23, and they occupy 1 liter, yeah, which is 22.4 decimeters cubed. That means inversely, yeah, that per molecule we've got 37 times 10 to the power of minus 21 centimeters cubed. Yeah. Now imagine if we arrange those molecules, yeah, in a simple cubic lattice. Yeah, then the smallest distance between two molecules would be, well, round about 33 times 10 to the power of minus 8 centimeters, yeah? So then we would have 36 times 10 to the power of minus 21 centimeters cubed per molecule, yeah? So just slightly lower than that. So despite the low density of a gas, yeah, spatial separation of gas particles is actually relatively small, yeah? Now remember from lecture 2, when we look at the velocity distribution for nitrogen, yeah, different temperatures, then we see that under the same conditions, so room temperature, yeah, 295 Kelvin, the average velocity of the nitrogen molecules is, well, somewhere around 400 to 450 meters per second. Yeah, so given the small available volume and the high velocity of gas molecules, yeah, we must assume that gas molecules undergo a very large number of collisions, yeah, per time. So their path, yeah, in a gas, or like for example in the air surrounding us, the path of these gas molecules is probably a very complicated zigzag movement. Yeah. So now to calculate the mean free path, so it means the distance that a gas molecule travels on average between two collisions, yeah, we start from this model assumption here, yeah, that depicts gas molecules as rigid spheres, yeah. So if we have one molecule with a radius R1 and another with a radius R2, then as this figure shows, the closest they can get to each other is this distance R1 plus R2, yeah, which we will call R12, yeah, here in these calculations. Yeah, so as a consequence here, yeah, we call this volume, yeah, the exclusion volume, and this is given by half Avogadro's number times 4/3 pi R12 cubed. Yeah. So now a collision will occur when the colliding molecule hits this circle. The circle of radius R, R12. So we therefore refer to this area as sigma equals pi R12 squared. And we call this collision cross section. So now we will first ask for the probability with which a molecule has collided with another molecule after passing through a distance delta x, given that we have a number density of molecules of 1n. So for this purpose we will consider a cuboid volume with a base surface area A here in black and a thickness of delta x. Now note here the assumption which I'm making. So delta x is much smaller than R12. So why did I choose this? Well, so that we have no possible collision cross sections behind this plane of projection. So in this example, essentially the number of circles is equal to the number of molecules in the volume A delta A times delta x. So it means the number of molecules is then given by the number density 1n times A times delta x. So we can get the probability W here. So that a point molecule entering this gas volume perpendicular to A will hit another gas molecule that is thought to be at rest. We can give this as the ratio of the sum of the circular area sigma to the frontal area A. So this is expressed by the number density 1n times the total surface area A times the collision cross section sigma times the thickness delta x divided by A, the total area. So this will be our W is equal to 1n times sigma times delta x. So next, we want to determine the number n dot x of molecules that have not yet encountered another molecule. And it's clear that their number essentially decreases between x and x plus dx by this number here, by dn dot x, which is given here in equation 2.2. So dn dot x is equal to minus n dot x, so the number of molecules that have not yet encountered another molecule, times 1n times sigma times dx. At the same time, we introduce this abbreviation alpha. Alpha corresponds to 1n times sigma. We get here then to equation 2.3. And by indefinite integration, we essentially get here, logarithmus naturalis of n dot x or ln n dot x is equal to minus alpha x plus a constant c. So we can calculate this constant c from the initial conditions, which means that nx n dot x equals n dot 0 at x equals 0. And we get then here as equation 2.5, ln n dot 0 equals 0 plus c. So our constant c is essentially the ln of n dot 0 at the distance of 0. Okay, so now when we combine equation 2.4 and 2.5, this will give us the fraction of a particle stream that has not yet undergone a collision after passing through a distance x. So this is the fraction n dot x divided by n dot 0 which is equal to e to the power of minus alpha x, yeah, and we know what alpha is here, so this is equal to e to the power of minus 1 n sigma x. Yeah, so now we can combine equation 2.2 and 2.6, yeah, to get the number of particles that collide between x and x plus dx. Yeah, so these particles have just about the free path, the free path length of x. Yeah, so in order to obtain the mean free path, yeah, lambda, we have to multiply the free path length x, yeah, by the number of particles, yeah, then sum these products over all values of x, yeah, so from 0 to infinity, and divide by the total number of particles. Yeah, so this is pretty much what we've done here. So divide by the total number of particles, n dot zero, yeah, and sum over all values. Yeah, so we get here equation 2.8. Yeah, now luckily again this is one of these trig interval integrals. Yeah, so this partial integration gives us a value 1. Yeah, so we can essentially get here for the mean free path equation 2.9. So mean free path lambda is equal to 1 over alpha. Yeah, we know what alpha is. So alpha is 1 n times sigma. Yeah, so this is the important equation here. So we could have also arrived at this result, yeah, if we had considered that a particle between two collisions, yeah, passes through the volume sigma times lambda, yeah, in which there is exactly one other particle, namely the one that is being hit, yeah, and the particle density is then 1n, yeah, equals to 1 over sigma times lambda. So we now sort of see by comparing equations 2.6 and 2.9, we can see that we can substitute the exponent of this e function here, yeah, simply by x over lambda. Yeah, why? Yeah, we simply can express here n 1 n sigma, yeah, in terms of lambda, yeah, and substitute for lambda. So we get here e to the power of minus x over lambda. Yeah. So the particle flux hence decreases, yeah, after passing through the mean free path length, yeah, by collisions with other molecules, and it pretty much decreases to 1 over e of its original value here. Yeah, so you sort of see here, yeah, as we pass through 1 over lambda, 2 over lambda, 3 over lambda, and so on, the number of particles that have not undergone any collisions yet decays exponentially here with n dot x over n dot zero, yeah, from 100% to, well, negligible amounts. Yeah, so the graph here shows essentially the current of molecules or the flux of molecules that have not yet been involved in a collision, yeah, as a fraction of the spatial coordinate x, yeah, and related to the mean free path lambda. Yeah, and the relationship we derived here has been also confirmed experimentally, yeah, with the aid of this Knudsen cell, yeah, that we've seen in lecture 2, yeah, without the this rotating cylinder here in the grooves. This was for velocity separation. Yeah, so here we have essentially a particle beam that was passed through a diluted gas, yeah, and then the beam intensity was measured here on our detector D, yeah, at different distances x, and this is how you generate such a plot also experimentally. So now let's look at the mean free path of gas molecules in three-dimensional space, yeah, with three-dimensional movement, which is the more applicable and more general case, yeah, especially if you look at the gas surrounding us. Yeah, so remember from the previous slides, yeah, in determining the mean free path, we have assumed that only the colliding molecule is moving, yeah, but that the other molecules are at rest. Yeah. Now in the 3D case, we also need to consider the relative velocity of the colliding molecules, and not just the velocity of the incoming molecule. Yeah. So if the relative velocity, this one here, was a certain factor greater, yeah, than the velocity of a colliding molecule, yeah, this would lead automatically to a shortening of the time until the collision. Yeah, so in this case, the molecules would net approach each other, yeah, faster. So, and this would of course lead to a shortening of the mean free path, yeah, of the incoming molecule, yeah, and hence a different lambda. So we can obtain the relative velocity according to this figure here in the top left hand corner, yeah, by subtracting the velocity vectors of the colliding molecules. Yeah, so we subtract the velocity vector of the colliding molecule from the velocity vector of the molecule that undergoes the collision. Yeah, so we calculate here the magnitude of a relative velocity, yeah, as an equation 2.10. Yeah, using simply Pythagoras here. Yeah, so we get the relative velocity squared is equal to, yeah, the magnitudes of vector 1 squared plus the magnitude of vector 2 squared minus 2v1 v2 cos theta. Yeah, this angle here between the velocity vectors. Yeah, so this is for in-plane movement. Yeah, so now of course, for 3D movement, we have to average the relative velocity over all possible orientations of vectors v1 and v2. Yeah. So, of course, as a consequence, yeah, these cosine terms are eliminated. Yeah, because they take positive and negative values equally. Yeah. So we essentially get then equation 2.11. Yeah. But now we have a problem. Yeah. We have essentially unknown v squared dash values, yeah, for the two different partaking molecules. Okay, so now to determine this mean value of velocity squared, we essentially integrate, yeah, from 0 to infinity the product of a velocity squared and this normalized distribution function of velocities. Yeah, this is from the mean velocity function here. Remember from lecture, I think it was lecture 2. Yeah, so we get essentially this entire expression here, equation 212. Yeah. So in this case, again, we integrate from 0 to infinity and expand v by square root of m divided by 2kt, yeah, and we get equation 2.13. Now this looks really quite complex, yeah, but again, it's one of the trig functions, yeah. So this has a form integral from 0 to infinity of x to the power of 4, yeah. So this is this expression here times e to the power of minus x squared. So this is this expression here, yeah, by dx. And this essentially gives us a value 3/8 times square root of pi. Yeah. So it means for the mean value of the velocity squared, yeah, we get here expression 2.14. Yeah, the average velocity square, which is 3 times kt over m. Yeah. So now we can use equation 2.14, yeah, to plug it in here. And so we first obtain for the general case, yeah, this expression here that the molecules differ in their masses. Yeah, so essentially now We have the relative velocity, the average relative velocity squared is equal to 3RT over mass of molecule 1 plus 3RT over mass of molecule 2. Yeah, so now we can essentially get 3RT over mass 1. You have the incoming molecule out, yeah, times 1 plus m1 by m2. Equals v squared of 1. So this is the speed we know, yeah, because this is essentially a particle beam but it's passing through a gas, yeah, times in brackets 1 plus m1 over m2. So now let us consider the special case where particles have essentially the same masses, yeah, m1 equals m2. So this would be the case if we accelerated a particle beam of, let's stay with the previous examples, a particle beam of nitrogen, yeah, and pass it through a dilute volume of, yeah, other nitrogen particles. Yeah, so then we essentially get here our equation 2.16. Yeah, so all of this essentially simplifies quite a bit. And now remember from the previous lectures, yeah, we found that essentially the mean velocity squared, yeah, or the root of a mean velocity squared, and the mean velocity and the most frequent velocity, that they differ only by constant factors. Yeah, so we've seen that in lecture 2. I asked you back in the day just to appreciate these ratios. Yeah, now they come in handy because now we can express the relative velocity, yeah, as square root 2 times the mean velocity of species 1, yeah, here in equation 2.17. Yeah, so what does that actually mean? It means that the averaged relative velocity is larger than the mean velocity of a colliding particle in the outer coordinate system, yeah, by a factor of square root 2. Yeah, then according to our previous considerations, essentially the mean free path length must be smaller by a factor of 1 divided by square root 2. Yeah, so this comes in here. Yeah, so this is essentially an expression for the corrected mean free path, yeah, and it's called Maxwell's mean free path here in equation 2.18. Yeah, you've seen that before when we calculated the mean free path. Yeah, so this one is essentially corrected now for the relative motion. Yeah, so according to our rigid sphere model, yeah, the sum of atomic radii R12, yeah, is a constant independent of pressure and of temperature, and we also know that the particle number density 1n is equal to p, the pressure, over kt, yeah, and is directly proportional to the pressure. Yeah, so the number density is directly proportional to the pressure, and consequently, yeah, essentially the mean free path at constant temperature is inversely proportional to pressure. Yeah, inversely, this means if we keep the density 1n constant, yeah, the mean free path is then independent of pressure. So now let's refine our model a little bit further. Yeah, so we already consider three-dimensional movement, that's great. Yeah, but now particles might also be interacting, yeah, so we might be experiencing attractive forces. Yeah, so in the absence of attractive forces, we essentially found that a collision occurs only, yeah, when the trajectory of a colliding particle was at most, yeah, a distance of R12 away from the center, yeah, of a particle that is undergoing the collision. So now in the presence of attractive forces, yeah, we might still get a collision at a slightly larger distance, BKR. Yeah, so here are the incoming particles. Yeah, normally we would only hit if it's within R12, Yeah, but now we might also hit when we are at BKR away from the center. So here's a center, that's a relative distance, BKR. Yeah, so even this incoming particle might just about hit another, because its trajectory will take a slightly different curve thanks to this attractive central symmetrical potential here. Yeah. So this critical collision parameter, yeah, was essentially calculated by William Sutherland, yeah, in a couple of papers on the viscosity of gases, yeah, back in 1893. So here he is in his 20s. Now let's see how we deal with the maths. So let's briefly outline Sutherland's thought process here. Yeah, so we essentially assume that the molecule that is just about to undergo collision, yeah, is at rest, and we attribute the reduced mass here mu, yeah, to the colliding molecule. Yeah, we do this, yeah, because we have the central motion, yeah, the central motion that changes the trajectory of the incoming particle, yeah, due to a centrally symmetric attractive potential. Yeah, and in such a motion, it's clear, it's just like, well, sort of like planetary motion. Yeah, we have to have a conservation of angular momentum. Yeah, as a consequence, we get here equation 2.19. Yeah, where theta here, yeah, here a little bit in a clearer sketch, where theta is the angle of impact. Yeah. So now we see that from the central sketch here, yeah, that for very large distances between two particles, yeah, so very far away, theta will be then very, very small, yeah. So we can essentially simplify to get d theta over dt, yeah, is approximately equal to d sine theta over dt. Yeah, so we get here this expression. This expression 2.20. Yeah. Now minus dr over dt, yeah, at large distances is equal to our relative velocity. Yeah. So dr is then the distance traveled over dt. This is our relative velocity then. Hence, we can combine here equation 2.19 and equation 2.20, and we get an expression for the constant c. Yeah. So essentially, we find that mu times r squared times d theta over dt equals mu times b times the relative velocity. Okay, so we saw previously that our constant c essentially is mu times b times the relative velocity. Now, in addition to this area theorem that we applied previously, we must also apply the law of conservation of energy. Yeah, and at small distances, we have two contributions. Yeah, potential energy, epsilon p, independence of the distance r, and the kinetic energy contribution here, yeah? So 1/2 times the mass times velocity squared, yeah? And these are essentially the relative velocities which we calculated previously, yeah? So hence, applying conservation of energy, we get here for 1/2 times mu times v relative squared, we get essentially 1/2 times mu times big brackets r squared d theta by dt squared plus dr by d2 squared. Yeah. So now we can essentially solve. Yeah. Here 2 to 1. Yeah. For d theta t. So what is d theta t here expressed in this? So it would be essentially mu times v relative divided by mu divided by r squared. And we substitute that in, yeah, to get equation 2.23. Yeah, so we essentially get here this expression, eliminating d theta by dt. And now we have a special case, yeah, when the two particles are just touching. Yeah, in this case, our B equals to BKR. Yeah, this additional distance, yeah, that still causes a collision. Yeah, so this is essentially been the case. And in this case, the moment that the particles touch, R is equal, we know what R then is, yeah, R is our R1, 2. So, and we now know, yeah, because R is at its minimum, yeah, R equals to R1, 2, we get dr over dt equals zero. Yeah, they can't approach each other further. Yeah, so these two, this equation essentially simplifies to 1/2 times mu times bkr squared times relative velocity squared divided by r12 squared plus here's our potential energy contribution epsilon p at the distance r12 equals 1/2 times mu times the relative velocity squared. Yeah, so now we can solve for BKR. Yeah, and this is the expression that we get. Yeah, so this is now the slightly larger distance, yeah, at which collisions can occur. So now let's try to work with this expression for a critical distance BKR. Yeah, so taking equation 2.15 that you saw previously for relative speed of particles with different masses, if we now divide here the numerator and denominator by Avogadro's number in A, we get to molecular quantities. Yeah, so that would give us expression 2.26 here. Yeah. So that is 3kT times m1 plus m2 divided by m1 times m2. Now you know this bit already. Yeah, this is essentially the inverse of our reduced mass. So we can essentially write this as 3kT divided by mu. Yeah, and this we can plug into our expression for BKR. So the average of the relative velocity square goes in here. Yeah, and we can express BKR here. Yeah, now we know that equation 2.27 solely depends on the temperature, yeah, and the radii of the colliding molecules, yeah, with everything else being constant. Yeah, so this is essentially this constant here is the Sutherland constant. Yeah, note here, yeah, that the potential energy contribution epsilon p, yeah, at the distance r12, yeah, so just when the molecules touch, this is negative, yeah, since this is an attractive force, yeah, and as a consequence, the Sutherland constant c is positive, yeah, hence we can write here our equation 2.29, BKR squared is equal to the radius 1/2 squared times in brackets 1 plus Sutherland constant over t. Yeah, so according to our considerations at the beginning, yeah, we find that in the presence of an attractive force, yeah, we can substitute r12 by our critical distance BKR. Yeah, so we can essentially plug that in here into our expression for Maxwell's mean free path, yeah, into sigma. So our r12 is hidden here within our sigma. Yeah, remember what sigma was. Yeah, so this was essentially pi times r12 squared. Yeah, with sigma being our collision cross section. Yeah, and we essentially get then for the mean free path, yeah, taking into account intermolecular interactions, we get equation 2.30. Yeah, now think back what we said about the Sutherland constant c, yeah, that it is positive. since we have an attractive potential energy, yeah, and this expression is negative. Yeah, so from equation 2.30, we essentially see automatically, yeah, that BKR is larger than R12. Yeah, so this means essentially that the mean free path is reduced in the presence of an attractive force between molecules. Yeah, and this was essentially our initial assumption. Yeah, now we also have a division of a Sutherland constant C, yeah, by the temperature T here in equation 2.30. Yeah, this means that the reduction of a mean free path between interacting molecules, yeah, will be less severe the higher the temperature. Yeah, so at high temperatures, this attractive potential doesn't matter so much anymore. Yeah. And let us further note, yeah, this factor, yeah, 3/2 times kT, yeah, so inverse of this expression here in red. Yeah, what is this? Yeah, this is nothing but the kinetic energy of the colliding molecule. Yeah, so it should become clear that we are dealing here with an interplay between the temperature-independent potential energy, yeah, epsilon p, and the temperature-dependent kinetic energy here, yeah. So this is essentially contributing towards a critical distance. So this means the higher the kinetic energy, yeah, the smaller is the ratio epsilon p R12 over epsilon kinetic, yeah, and hence the smaller is the deflection of a colliding particle, and the smaller the deflection of a colliding particle is, the larger is the mean free path, obviously. So this brings us to the end of this lecture, and next time around we'll be looking at transport properties of gases, yeah, and in particular we'll be looking at effusion and diffusion. See you next time.